Hello and welcome to the lecture on blockchain. Well, blockchain has been quite a hype over the last years. I mean, so much that it is almost strange to have a lecture on it in some contexts, I think, because, I mean, so many people argue about it. So there's, on the one hand, people who say, well, this is the final state of achieving an anarchist democracy. So it's really saving us from all the problems that we have in normal governments. And the other side argues, well, that's some kind of neoliberal delusion by weird Silicon Valley dudes. And interesting enough, as my personal opinion, I mean, it is not that it is in between, but it is both. So I think that the blockchain as a technology has promises that are really super interesting to pursue. And on the other hand, the culture that is around it also I find deeply disturbing. So at the same time, both of these promises that it is totally horrible and it is totally wonderful, I think are true. So let's have a look what this blockchain is. Much, as we will see, is about finding trust in distributed systems, why we would need that and why it is difficult. For that, we will construct a consensus mechanism. That means that people who are distributed will find a common ground on what is truth in the system. We will look in transactions, because that is why the blockchain was invented originally as a way of transferring money. And how that has to do with blocks, that gives the technology its name. And what about smart contracts? That's another buzzword that hovers around blockchain. And finally, I want to introduce you into some real applications beyond just sending money that the blockchain makes possible. Yeah, Brian Behlendorf, who is a quite famous Silicon Valley personality, known, for example, of being co-founder of the Electronic Frontier Foundation and many other things. He is the founder of the Apache Foundation also, so he's really a personality in the open source software community, and also as an investor with connections to Peter Thiel, with whom he ran a venture capital fund called Mitral Capital, first investor into Palantir Technologies. So I can go on now talking about him. But then you see, I mean, his take on blockchain. So he says corruption or bureaucracy or inefficiency. So all these three things is what many people kind of blame governments for. So they are corrupt, politicians are always corrupt, and the bureaucracy is totally inefficient and it's annoying and so on. So, and he says now the surprising thing is technological problems. And that is not what we usually think of it. We usually think it's people. It's people who are corrupt, it's people who are lazy, who do stupid things in the government and no one really oversees them. And so instead of seeing it as a social and psychological problem, he says, no, it's a technological problem and so we can fix it. And this is very interesting. So, because in a way, on the one hand, that is the fallacy of Silicon Valley, this technological solutionism. So everything in the world is just an engineering problem. On the other hand, I mean, let's just see what's behind it. And some things are surprisingly powerful in the technology, as Brian Behlendorf here says. So why is he so confident in technology? I mean, step away back and think of what is the most important property of the internet. I mean, of course, the internet is full of content and you can share content, you can send emails, you can send data, so many systems can be connected. But why is that so different from any network that was there before? Well, the point is that the internet, while using technology that had been around for a long time, puts on top of it accessibility by being totally open. So everyone can just put up their computer, plug it in, and run software to connect it to the internet. There is no hurdle to that. I mean, of course, I mean, in national regulations, you might not be allowed to do that, but in general, it's very easy. There's no technological hurdle to do that other than knowing how to do it. So that's the first thing. It is totally open. It is global. So everyone in the world, I mean, about 80% of the world has access to the internet. Almost every adult person has a smartphone that is somehow connected to the internet. So it is truly global. It is transnational. So no country dominates it, although, of course, there is a historic importance of the United States, not only being a very strong economic power, but I mean just inventing it and so being the first to have it. But if you think of China, for example, having their totally autonomous internet behind the Great Firewall, you see that it is no longer just the domain of one country. It is truly transnational. It is borderless in a way. And it is to some extent sensor resistant. You need to do really a lot to prevent people from using the internet to get things. I mean, of course, there is a lot of censorship technology installed that tries to solve the problem that everyone can just share whatever they want. But it is, in a way, easy to circumvent it. And the only really successful way of censoring is to punish it so that people are afraid to share information. So it is basically accessible for anyone. And anyone can come up with new ideas on it without asking for permission. So that makes it kind of the dream environment for startups. So this is the internet. But the internet has one thing that it doesn't do well, and that is handling authenticity. So why is it so incredibly hard to send money via the internet? I mean, because I don't know if someone actually has the money. I mean, someone sends me an email and say, I give you $1,000. And I say, well, that's nice, but where are the $1,000? So this is the one thing that the internet is not built to do well, because the internet was built to do exactly the opposite, to be sharing things freely, to copy things as much as possible. So every time we call a website with a web browser, actually the file is copied from the server where it sits to our computer. So copying is the purpose of the internet as we know it. And the idea behind the blockchain, as we shall see, is add another layer of protocol, add another layer of network technology on top of the existing internet that makes it possible to have files that are unique. And by that, basically say, well, this file is money, and if someone hands it over to you, he doesn't have, or they have, doesn't have it anymore, and you have it. So that is a great promise. Wynton Cerf is one of the fathers of the internet, that is how it's usually attributed, because he's one of the inventors of the protocol on which the internet runs, TCP/IP. Needless to say, with this chart, he expresses that he actually don't think that blockchain does this job. Just mentioning, not every technology person is entirely supportive of the idea that blockchain is a great thing. So what is the blockchain? I mean, let's start with just a normal language definition. So it is a distributed technology. That means it runs on many separate computers. And it is decentralized. That means none of these computers is hierarchically above the others. So everyone is the same. That is already two very important criteria. If you think of a database, usually you have one big database server, and clients, even if they are fully capable computers, ask the database via an API call, what is the state of, for example, my bank account? What is the state of the temperature outside? So the database replies to you from their central position. So it is distributed and decentralized, and it is cryptographically secured. So there is a lot of crypto. This is why we talk about crypto synonymously when we talk about blockchain, in the sense of cryptology. Crypto, cryptos, krypton means hidden. Krypton is the hidden. And so cryptology is the language, is the science of hiding things. And that means you can cryptographically secure things that keep them secret and safe. It is immutable and a database. So that is important to know. The blockchain is basically, first of all, a database. You could even say it's an accounting system, it's a bookkeeping system. It is cryptographically secured, as many bookkeeping systems are, like for example SAP or other, but it is also distributed and decentralized. But first of all, it is immutable, that means no one can change it. And that means really no one can change it. And that is something very special, something that is required for good bookkeeping, that you can't change your books after the fact. So if you book a transaction, for example, a monetary transaction, the trade laws in all countries of the world require you to keep the book in an immutable way. And that is usually not what electronic databases are very good at, because, I mean, in electronics, I mean, in digital technology, you can just overwrite things. So it's an immutable database and an immutable computing system, even, as we shall see. It has a consensus mechanism. That means there is a way all the connected nodes agree what is the state in which the database is at. For example, if you think again of a bank, all the nodes agree on the balance on all the accounts in your bank. And in a normal banking system, you don't need that, because the normal banking system is centralized and not distributed. So you have one ledger, one central database that is the source of truth, and all the clients, for example, the ATMs by which you withdraw money, or the bank clerk behind their counter looking at your balance or so, they all just ask this one centralized database, which is the true state of your bank account. But if we don't have a hierarchical system, I mean, that is not possible, because there is no single source of truth. And so you have to create a single source of truth by consensus. And that is truly something non-trivial and completely new. And finally, and that is the most impressive thing that has been impressively really demonstrated by more than 10 years that blockchain technology has been around, it is resilient to attacks. So it is very hard to break the system, and even if someone intrudes it and corrupts it, it is very easy after the fact to detect and to correct a corruption. So to understand the thinking about it, we step back into less technological questions and have a look into similar problems in history. So very famous is the final siege of Byzantium, of Constantinople, in 1453. So the Ottoman Sultan Mehmed II finally wanted to fulfill the Quranic prophecy in opening the capital of the East Roman Empire to Islam. And so he besieged Byzantium. Byzantium had been besieged in earlier times, but so far not successfully by the Ottomans, and had a huge army gathered around the city that you see here depicted in a map that is about 150 years old from a Turkish schoolbook. So what you see here is the Bosporus and the so-called Golden Horn. You see that the city is surrounded by water from three sides, and only from one side you can access it by land. So if you think of all these armies that you see here depicted, let's make them a bit more visible. So that is Mehmed and his generals as symbolizing all these armies around. So you have people in the water, I mean with ships, so that the besieged can't escape and so on. So they are really distributed about across a huge distance. And I mean, no radio at that time, so you can't, or no telephone. So Mehmed giving orders can't just give his generals a call. What he has to do is send dispatches, send messengers from one to the next. And since the city is so big and the circumference is so vast, that takes a long time, and basically you have to go through each general in between. And of course, the other way around, the same. And now came an interesting plot that, I mean, the legend says at least, the emperor in Constantinople tried to do against the Ottomans. They tried to bribe one of the generals, because it was known that if one of the generals would act unfaithful to the Sultan, probably it would be possible for the troops that were caught in the city to break out and start a battle on the field. And so the idea was to bribe one of the generals that was distant from the Sultan to give conflicting messages to both sides, and to trust that the generals next to the corrupt one would then act in an inconsistent way. For example, one would get the message to retreat, and the other would get the message to attack, and by that create weakness and give the opportunity for a counterattack. Well, we know from history that it didn't happen, or at least it was not successful, because Constantinople fell and became then the glorious capital of the Ottoman Empire, today's Istanbul. But the question, the strategic question of military command lines here remains, and of course became incredibly important once weapons became more and more destructive. And that is in particular the case in the 20th century with the rise of nuclear weapons. So in the 1950s, in the US in particular, but as well probably also in the Soviet Union, military strategists were increasingly concerned about the possibility of a surprise nuclear attack that would just take out most of the command infrastructure. And I think of a nuclear attack on Washington DC and maybe two other major cities, and in all that chaos and destruction, probably the military would no longer function to plan a counterattack and defend themselves or at least retaliate. And the Advanced Research Program, ARPA, of the United States military was given the task of coming up with solutions for that. And they had their famous Research and Development Corporation, RAND, Research and Development, where a lot of engineers and computer scientists and mathematicians were working on these esoteric problems. And here you see a famous graphic that was published by RAND in 1960 by an engineer and computer scientist, Paul Barron. So Paul Barron makes this classification of different network architectures and says, usually we think of military as a centralized architecture. We have one head of command giving out orders to the soldiers. Even if that is decentralized, we have still one command, and then we have the sub-commanders, for example, the Sultan in the middle and the generals commanding their regiments. And then the colonels commanding their battalions and so on down. So we have kind of a decentralized organization in most military, not fully centralized because they are too big, but still, I mean, if you destroy the central hub, the generals might not know what to do, as we have seen in the example of Constantinople. So the proposition here is, why not build something that is completely decentralized and non-hierarchical, so that is distributed and decentralized. And that is the distributed network, the C that you see here. Sorry. And you might have seen the chart here before, because this specific illustration of what then later becomes the internet became almost synonymous for the internet's architecture. We see it in many presentations to this day that have to do with networks. You could imagine this kind of mesh of nodes and the edges between the nodes really enshrouding the whole world as it does now. However, the problems of the Byzantine generals is the same here still. What if the Soviet Union would just take over some of the nodes and spread wrong information through the network? So that is not solved by it. So we need another take on it, and that took a while for people to come up with an idea. One of the influential computer scientists working on that problem is a famous cryptographer from Great Britain, Leslie Lamport. So Lamport used first, I think, the metaphor of the siege of Constantinople and called it the Byzantine fault tolerance problem, the problem of the Byzantine generals. So the question is, how many nodes do you have to take out to actually make the system fail? And he created a whole theory on that. So, and that is and that is what we will explore in the next time. So the problem of distributed networks, in other words, is that to create consistency, we need some kind of authority that tells everyone in the network what's right or wrong. And that creates a problem because it clashes with either the availability of the network or the tolerance to be fully distributed. To give you an example, think of ATMs, of money dispensers, of cash dispensers, of banks. So they are clearly distributed, I mean, they sit everywhere, and you go there, put your credit card in, and type in your PIN, and then expect the machine to dispense money. So what usually happens in hidden behind the machine is that the machine calls the bank, data call, of course, I mean, an automatic call, and requests the current balance of your bank account. So what if for some reason the server is busy? I mean, there might be just many people withdrawing money at the same time or so. It might be maintenance or so. So the central database might just not be available. Well, I mean, then you could just not get money, because otherwise you could just get the money out more than you own and go to the next machine and get even more money out. So that is a problem for banks. And because they have to choose somehow, either they trust you that you don't withdraw more than you actually own, or the machine might just not give you money at all because it might not get an answer for the server. So that is the clash between the three properties. Either I want consistency, I want to be sure that I have the money, or the machine is always available, or I give up on the property of that the machines are distributed and I have to go to some kind of centralized branch of the bank where someone literally looks up in the database. And that is known as the CAP theorem, CAP theorem, and has been believed to be unbreakable. I mean, it's a mathematically not too demanding proof that you can have only two of the three at a time. And so there is no solution in classic programming code. There is no solution that you solve in a logic way. And as often in mathematics, people sometimes get the idea, well, it doesn't work in that field, it doesn't work in logic, let's try to see the problem in another field. And that's what the person or the people who invented Bitcoin, we don't know who that was because they run under a pseudonym, Satoshi Nakamoto. There is no person with that name. So it might be one person, it might be several people who came up with this ingenious idea, this really inspired use of mathematics to not solve the problem of having a fully distributed and consistent database in logic, but to transform it into the realm of probability theory. So why it is not possible to have an accurate answer at any second if the balance is right, we shall see that the consensus mechanism that Satoshi proposed in the Bitcoin white paper in 2008 is creating an approximate consistency, is a consistency in a stochastic way that converges to a stable state. So at a certain moment, if I just look at the most recent transactions, I might still have an uncertainty. But if I look back a bit of time, say an hour or two, I can be reasonably sure that everything is totally consistent and will not be able to be changed. So in average, my request will be consistent. So, and that is really, really very smart to use this game theoretic plot to have this consensus. And we will look at the first, at the original consensus mechanism that was proposed in the Bitcoin white paper, which is called the proof of work. For the proof of work, we have to understand the concept of a hash. I will explain what a hash is. A hash is a function, a mathematical function, that takes arbitrary input and creates always a fixed length output. So you could think of a hash, for example, being a number. So you have, for example, students in class, you have 10 students in class, and you give every student a number from 1 to 10. Then this number is a hash, because it is a number of fixed length, 0, 1, 0, 2, 0, 2, another until 1, 0, and it's unique to each student. And in the same way, the hashing algorithms that we will look at, the cryptographic hashing algorithms, assign very long numbers to arbitrary inputs. And that sounds like a very interesting task, and indeed it is. So there is a very famous and most used, the so-called secure hashing algorithms, SHA, SHA, which had been developed over time by the National Security Agency in the US, have been made public and usually are tested by people to be secure over like a decade or so, because they are actually put into use. So we can rely that the cryptography behind the hashes is actually working. So to do that, I will now switch to code. What I do is I use the Anaconda environment to have my Jupyter notebooks. So if you have installed that, please take the time now to open a new Jupyter notebook. Otherwise, you can just use any code editor and just put in your code there. So what we start with is not Bitcoin yet, but an algorithm invented to do something different, but it's related on the internet. In 1997, Adam Beck, a computer scientist, was annoyed by the rising amount of spam. So spam is one of these unfortunate consequences that the internet is so open. So it has to do with the same problem. I mean, everyone can just hook their computer up and send out emails in vast quantities without actually much cost. And so what is spam? Spam is basically unwarranted email to indiscriminate many people with a very low return. I mean, maybe one in a million or even less people actually find the spam worth replying to it. So it's incredibly wasteful, but the person who sends it out doesn't have to pay. And so Adam Beck thought, well, how can we mitigate it? I mean, why doesn't spam happen in the real world? So in the real world, delivering a message has costs. So we go, for example, to the post office and buy a stamp. What is a stamp? A stamp is a proof that we paid the money for the mail to be delivered. But obviously there is nothing comparable online because we can't put a stamp on our email. So we have to create another proof that we paid the money, that we did the work for the mail to be delivered. And this is how it works. So the algorithm is called Hashcash, and was published in 1997, unfortunately not implemented in email, but What's then the inspiration for Bitcoin? So we use the library hashlib that Python provides, so that we don't have to program the cryptographic algorithms here ourselves. And from hashlib, we will shall use the secure hashing algorithm 2, SHA-2 or SHA-255 as it is called, for our experiment here. So we have some kind of input that we take in our, let's define an input string that we want to hash. As always, this is a boring sentence. And to hash it, we will have to create to turn that into byte values because the SHA algorithm only takes bytes. So we convert it to our test bytes by just using the bytes function. We have our input string, which is encoded in UTF-8. So that's now bytes. I mean, I can show you how that looks. Print that, and you see has bytes. I mean, still the same letters, obviously, but it says has the B and says by that it is converted. So and our test bytes, we now create our hash from by calling the hash function and display it. So let's just have our hash here. And you see, it is a quite impressive long hexadecimal number. We can convert that in a number that we can read better. So let's say h int. An integer now, and display that in the format that we can understand how big the number is. Let's call this h x. We have to print it in decimal, and this is the format by which we get the exponential way of displaying it. Run it again. So you see, it is about 6 times 10 to the 76. So if you ask yourself, I mean, why is that the case? I mean, SHA-256 creates a number that is 256 bits long. So a bit, you know, is 0 and 1, and if you have 256 bits, that's 2 to the 256. That's approximately 10 to the 77. So 10 to the 77 is kind of the proof. That's the maximum that we can express. And so the hashes that SHA-256 create are somewhere between 0 and 2 to the 256, which is 10 to the 77. And so here our hash, you see it's 64 characters long. our hash starts with a 7, so it is not quite at the top. That would be starting with 99999, and so on. It's FFFFF actually. So it's a bit down, and so it's 10 to the 76. And we can of course also look at that in binary. So if we convert that, let's say h bin is now bin of h int, so that gives it in zeros and one. But we want to see, we want to keep the length stable, so we fill the leading zeros so that we always have 256 digits, and print that also. In binary, and let's see. So you see here our number starts has quite some ones at the beginning. So it is now a number with 256 digits, all zeros and ones. So that's all the same numbers, all three, is our hash, the hash of our hello world. Now we can think of hashing a different string. Let's just add random other character to our hello world and run again. And you see, the string looks totally different. It's a completely different number. Let's just add other numbers here and let it run again. And you see, it's always different. It's never the same. But we can go back to our original string and see, it's again the same. So it is deterministic. So for each input, we get the same hash, but the hash is arbitrarily different, totally almost randomly different, even if only one bit is changed. And it's very handy because it is used, for example, to sign digital documents. So if you have a digital document and want to make sure that no bit is changed, so for example, no one changes a letter in it even, or adds words or deletes words from your document, you can hash it, and that is a signature. And you can send your hash in separate mail and say, this was my email, this is the hash of my email, and now you can calculate the hash of what you have received yourself and just see if your hash and my hash are the same. And if not, you know that someone has changed the email. The same is true for computer code. If you download computer code from the internet, I mean, of course, there could always be malicious code be sneaked in, viruses or whatever, and the original developer of the code usually issues a hash of the code file in a separate place, on a separate server. So even if someone corrupts the software that is downloaded, the computer can still check if the hash is the same, and by that verify that the code is legitimate. So now comes the idea of hash cache. So we can create some kind of game with it. As you see, I mean, the digits are either 0 or 1. So how likely is it, putting random things here, like the 1 or so, that this bit here is 0? Well, it's 50%. I mean, if I put something else here in here, like the 2, still 1. So now I have still only zero, still only ones. A bit tricky. But I know, for example, a string that does the job because I have calculated that before. This is a random number 4250. And if I put that in, you see suddenly I have a lot of leading zeros. So how likely is it to find that? Well, it depends on how many zeros you want in the beginning. So if you want one leading zero, you have to, in average, try at least once to find that, because it's 50% chance. If you want the first two digits to be zero, well, that's 2 times 50%, that is 25% probability. So I need, in average, try twice. And so if I want to have the first 10 digits all be zero, well, I mean, the probability to have that is 1 to 60,000 and something, because that 2 is 2 to the 10. So that's very unlikely. So I have to kind of calculate the 30,000 numbers. And if I require that, to require that the hash starts with these 10 zeros, well, then I have to do some work for it. I have to do 30,000 calculations, and that costs some money because it creates heat, that consumes electricity. And if I then show you, I have found a random string like I did here that does the job, then the recipient of the email knows, okay, he has done or she has done their calculations. And that is how we create the stamp, so to say. And I will now briefly walk you through the actual algorithm. So what we do here is I take an email. So I want to show you that in a real environment. So this email I get every day from this Croatian bookstore. And I might want to kind of filter that out. So what is an email? I mean, let's just look at the source code of the email. As you see, it's basically text. It's a lot of text in the so-called header, and then comes the content of the mail, which is usually HTML code. So yeah, I've put that also in an editor so that you can see it better. So, and the header is the interesting thing, because even if everyone gets the same body of the message, the header is always different because everyone has a different email address. So I get my unique email from that bookstore or from any kind of spam. So if I require a hash to be calculated that has a certain format, for example, has 10 leading zero, the sender of the email has actually to do the work, because they can't do it bulk-wise, because every email is different and every email will have a different hash. So I save this email as a file email HTML, and now put that into my code. This is the file name that I put in. I open the file. I read it as the bytes, so I read it as bytes. So I have my input bytes, that's basically the data of the email, and I create my hash here, just as I did earlier. Here you see it's exactly the same code here, and convert that, for a reason that you will soon understand, into a number, into an integer number, and have here my h. And now I create my difficulty. So the difficulty is basically how many leading zeros do I want? And I could phrase that differently and could say, well, if you look at that, so for example here with these leading zeros, if you remember the hello world without leading zeros, that is 10 to the 76. And now I add my my miraculous string here. It's not the right, like that. And now you see the number with the leading zeros is much smaller. It's 10 to the 73. It's still a big number, but it is 3 orders of magnitude less. So what I do is I require the hash to represent a smaller number. And that I do by asking, please calculate the hash so that it is smaller than my defined difficulty. So let's just start with just 2 orders of magnitude. Instead of 256, I have 254. And then I create what is called a nonce. So this string here that I add, this more or less random string that I try out to create the specific hash, is called nonce. That's a cryptographic word from not once. It doesn't mean anything. It's just called that way. So don't get hung up on it. And I say my nonce, I create in random alphanumeric sequences. And this is, I take from, I can do that in a different way also. I could just count numbers from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and just try these out one by the next. What I did here is I take another Python library, the secrets library, that has this random generator for alphanumeric code. And then I convert it into the bytes and concatenate it with my input code. So basically I create the email and add it to the bottom of it. And then I hash it and check if the hash fulfills my criteria. And otherwise, I just try again. Here I have a counter and I have some reports running, and let's just try it out. I mean, of course, our difficulty was not very difficult, so it immediately found a nonce, and you see it has two leading zeros, as we would expect. So let's make it a bit more difficult. 53. Now I need already 8 iterations, as I should expect. It becomes difficulty, and you see, now I go on, let's make it even more difficult, let's try 5 less, or 20 iterations. I mean, still, that's pretty easy, so try out what happens if we go down actually by 10 orders of magnitude. Yeah, and you see, after 4,000 iterations, I found the nonce. And that might for spamming already be sufficient. And if we go further down, it takes longer and longer. And as we will see, in Bitcoin, I don't require just 3, 4, or 10 orders of magnitude. I require 70 orders of magnitude down. So that the number of iterations required is trillions and trillions. It's called tera hashes that I have to calculate. We will now see how the hashcash algorithm is used in Bitcoin to secure transactions. So a transaction, you could think of a transaction as something like a message or an email by which you transfer money. But stay simple. So we have two people, say a person A and a person B, and A wants to transfer M to B. How do we do that? Usually, for example, say M is $120. And M has two bills, a bill R, say that is $50, and a bill S, that is, for example, $100. So to transfer $120, obviously, neither R or S are sufficient. They're both smaller, but R plus S are bigger than the amount I want to transfer. So I have to give the two bills and then receive change. And how does that work? So, I mean, I get M here and get back R plus S minus M. I mean, in our example, that's obviously $30. So this is my remainder that I have then. And what a bank system should do is say, well, I transfer these and these. And so after the transaction, B has M, and I have only this. And that's what we have to make sure. In a normal bank system, that is done with a database that just has the balance and says, well, first there were 150 and then 120 were spent and then 30 remain. But in a distributed system where everybody can just send out transactions, that is, of course, not possible. So how do we make possible that we don't receive money that someone doesn't have, that someone doesn't just send everybody messages? I send you 120 and you 120 and you 120 and double or triple or whatever, how many times spends the money. So we use the hashcash algorithm for that. If you think of the transaction in an electronic form, the transaction has a message body that says, for example, the amount that was 120, and that has some kind of referrer, for example, invoice number or whatever. So this is what usually we put into a bank transaction, and then it will have a header . The header is, for example, my bank account number and the recipient's bank account number and maybe other information like a timestamp and so on. So you can think of that, I mean, in our hashcash way, as a file that has a very unique number of bytes and structure. And what we do in the blockchain system, in Bitcoin, how that was initially described, is the person who wants to transfer money doesn't send the money just to one person, but distributes that to the network of Bitcoin nodes. So there's all the Bitcoin people, and they all receive, my message. And of course, they receive messages from other. And then what they do is they check. And we will look into that. And so it's 21 checks that they do by default. They look, does everything look right? Does this person actually has the money? So here comes all the chain. Do I have the bills electronic? Did I receive transactions that make me actually have the money in the first place? So all these checks are done, and then the nodes. I mean, if you look inside them, so let's look inside what's happening there. So all the transactions come like one after the other. They are packaged into a block and distributed to the network and says, I have a block. These transactions, I say, are all okay. And then all the other blocks can check if that is true. And now comes the interesting thing. How do I make sure that this the node that did the check doesn't do fraud here, doesn't sneak in fraudulent transactions and just transfer money, for example, to themselves or to their friends that no one actually had? Well, we must put a penalty on that. So if a person does that, or if a node does that, it must really hurt. And that is the idea of the consensus algorithm. So the blocks are formed, as I just showed, so all the transactions come in. And when about 2,000 transactions are together, the node forms the block and creates a header for that block that contains, this is so and so many transactions, this was this block number
something, 1,000, and so on. And now has to add to that block a nonce so that the hash of that block is fulfilling incredible high difficulty. So that is lower than the difficulty. The difficulty target, actually. It's called target. So, and that it could be a very small number. So there could be something like 70 orders of magnitude smaller than the 256 bits. So to find this nonce, it is not only necessary to try once, twice, or three times, but in average to try a trillion times. So we need to try a trillion times before we randomly find a nonce that would create a hash that starts with all the leading zeros as required by the difficulty. And once we have that, so let's say we have found this nonce. Okay, this block here has found the nonce. This miner here has found the nonce. I cry out to everyone else and send messages or say, I have it, here's the proof, I have the nonce, just calculate the hash yourself and look through the transactions, they are all legitimate and everything is fine. And everyone working on kind of the same block at that time says, oh yeah, he has it now, let's just go on and start the next block. And how is that rewarded? Well, I mean, if we look into the transactions in a second, we will see that the first transaction that this node adds, so this one here, is a transaction of money to yourself with a reward of currently 6.25 Bitcoin, which is about $300,000 at current exchange rates. So instead of getting paid by other people, I get paid by the system in creating bitcoins that were not there before, out of thin air, so to say. That is my reward, and that is called mining. So, and how do I prevent from just creating a wrong block and then getting the reward nevertheless? Well, the reward has a part, a code script attached to it that says only after 100 more blocks have been also successfully mined, successfully closed, this reward is validated. So if I try to spend the money earlier, every other miner will immediately see, well, he doesn't actually have the money, I don't have the money. They try to defraud the system. Only after the block number has increased by 100, I can spend the money. So I better be very careful in not making a mistake. Otherwise, I invested all the calculation time, all the energy that creating the hash with the nonce consumed, which is a lot. I mean, these trillions of operations that I did, that was all in vain because I wouldn't get the reward, because that 100 blocks later, no one realizes that I made a mistake or tried to defraud the system is very unlikely. So, and then is another thing. The block does not only contain the current transactions here, it also contains a hash of all previous blocks. So not only does this block secure the transactions current in the queue, it also secures every block before. And since the last block also had every block, this piles up. And so it becomes increasingly difficult to change blocks in the past, because I could otherwise go back and say, well, let's just tamper with blocks that have been closed in the past and sneak in transactions that actually didn't take place or delete transactions that were legitimate. No, I can't do that because then the hash would not longer be valid. And I mean, everyone else in the network can easily calculate that and can see, well, something has happened. And by that, the chain of blocks that kind of piled into each other gets immutable. So let's look a bit how that goes on. So this, so we call that mining because I mean I create these new bitcoins out of thin air. That's called mining. So here a block has found. Say this block is a miner in India, and they have found the right nonce and distribute to everyone else. And everyone else says, "Oh yeah, he has had it, or they have had it, she has had it." And then let's just go on, mine the next. And say, I mean, for example, this is a very successful operation in India. And so they go on. And the next is also in somewhere in Asia created and so on. But the next time something has happened, so one person in now, for example, in China finds the block and say like a second or two later, sometime someone in Canada finds the same nonce or not another nonce that does the trick. And since this miner here cries out to everyone, which means sending messages to the network, and this one is very far apart from each other, the network nodes that are say in the Americas and the network nodes that are, say, for example, in Asia or in Eurasia, might receive different confirmation messages. So people here in the West think it's the Canadian miner who found it. People here in the East, they think it's the Chinese miner. And what happens here is that we have suddenly two blocks that kind of represent the same truth. And what now goes on is that here the Western Hemisphere starts working on this block and the Eastern Hemisphere starts working on this block. But now comes the point with the probability. While that might happen once in a while, it is very unlikely that it happens twice in a row. And even if it happens one more time, I mean, how likely is it that it happens a third time? So after at least a few more blocks, one of these chains that have been created in this, what is called a fork, will have more blocks than the other. And then the miners on this side here will just say, we abandon that. We don't want to go further. We give up here. And this side is orphaned. This becomes an orphan chain. And so, I mean, just to give you a number, I mean, this this first generation fork here, so that two people somewhere in the world find the same block and then half the world works on the one and half the work on the second, that happens about every day. That repeats, that is still about every week. But then it becomes very rare. I mean, less than once a year, I think it is that that gets a length of 3, and never, I think, has it happened that it got a length of 4. So, and this is now the full algorithm. First, we have the transaction. The transaction has previous transactions. By which I got money and are basically messages to the network. And then we have the blocks, that is queues of transactions, They have a nonce by which the SHA-256 meets the difficulty target
and the difficulty target, by the way, is automatically adjusted by the system so that it takes always approximately 10 minutes to mine a new block. So when more people try to mine and the mining power becomes stronger because the computers get faster and faster, the difficulty rises so that in average the same amount of new bitcoins are minted, are mined. So we have the queue of transactions in a block, we have a nonce, and we have the hash of all previous blocks. And this is in a nutshell how Bitcoin works.
So now we can look into the blocks, for example here, blockchain.com, I mean these are these commercial companies by which you can trade, buy and sell a Bitcoin, a bit like banks, which seems contradictory to a distributed system, but I mean we will come to that in the next video. So we look at this Blockchain Explorer, and here you have the latest blocks, and you see it's random time intervals between two blocks because you can never know how long it takes until someone mines a block. Let's just open this one here. So this is the block 670,000 something. Here you see the hash of the block. It has already been confirmed twice by other miners. This is the number. So this is all the kind of header information that I was mentioning, and here are all the transactions. So the first transaction, here you see newly generated coins. That is the reward that someone pays to themselves. Near the next transaction is, here you see all kinds of complicated transactions. For example, here someone pays 0.037 and something Bitcoin to this address. These addresses are the public keys of people. So we have a system of public numbers. They are visible to everyone. So I can tell you my key, that is my account number, so to say. And towards this key, the money is booked. I can only retrieve it and only do other transactions if I have the secret key to this public key. So this is a person who received the money, and I can go further. And we can look at that also in raw format. So you see, this is how the block actually looks like. Make that a bit nicer by going to the Firefox computer. And because I have a plugin installed that displays the JSON data, here you have all the transactions listed with their keys and values. But we could look at the raw data also. Here you see the raw data and just display it in pretty print as a JSON. So you see it's a JSON format with key value pairs. Yeah, and this is how the blockchain looks. And I mean, at the end, the very end of these thousands is about 4 megabytes per block of transactions. We have about 2,000 people transferring money between each other. So, and here you see the fields, how that is structured. You can look that up in the Bitcoin documentation. An interesting remark is that you can add, as I mentioned, a referrer, like you would have in a bank transfer, what the transaction is about, so to say. That's a field with 80 bytes, so that's not a lot of text, but you can put some information in that. That's called the op record. The language in which this is formulated is a very interesting script language. It's very old, assembler style, Fort-like language. So it is very limited, and intentionally very limited, because that makes it safe. So you can't do arbitrary things with that language, but you can do in particular one thing. You can tie conditions to transactions. You can, for example, make a condition like only if someone else also paid money, like so I give money to pay something, but only if my friends also pay their part, my payment is validated. You can think of that as an escrow system, like the system keeps the money so kind of safe until the condition is fulfilled. Another condition we have already seen is the condition that a certain amount of time has passed, which means that, like, for example, 100 blocks have been mined, and before that I can't spend the money. And this is this measuring time in blocks that that are mined is the trick by which the CAP theorem gets, so to say, overwhelmed. So the trick is not to have an actual clock that says this transaction comes before this transaction. So if I spend money to one person and then spend money to another person, I need to know usually in which order this transaction takes place to know what the balance at the first transaction on my account was and what the balance on the second account was. But actually it is sufficient to know approximately which transaction came first. And this is how the blockchains measure time. They measure time not by an actual clock, but by the ticks of new blocks that are mined. So that is the ticks of our clock, is the number of blocks. And within one block, the order of the transaction is actually arbitrary. So two miners might get transactions in and order them totally at their discretion. So this is called a Lampert clock by Leslie Lampert, who initially coined the problem of the Byzantine generals and the idea of Byzantine fault tolerance. And generally, I mean, what we see with these systems, I mean, I think even if I try to explain it in a very simple way, I mean, you see it's quite complicated math and complicated procedural considerations that go in it. I mean, how do we trust it? And Andreas Antonopoulos, who is one of the, I think, best people to explain blockchain and to talk about it, so look him up on YouTube and watch his talks, he's a great speaker. So Andreas Antonopoulos, who also wrote the book Mastering Bitcoin, says here, I mean, where does authority generally come from? It comes from trust. And I mean, at the moment, I mean, we might not trust, for example, the New York Times, or we might not trust things that people write on Facebook or so. So that changes. Because, I mean, now we have the New York Times, but anyone can publish things on the internet. So that shifts that. And with Bitcoin, it's a bit the same. I mean, instead of trusting a bank, we have to trust the blockchain technology. And, I mean, of course, very few people are skilled enough to read the code and actually understand that the system is safe. We have to trust it because it seems to have been running over quite some time now without breaking down. And it is not without general dangers to have a system of fully distributed nodes like Bitcoin or Ethereum. We will look at Ethereum later. So there is the possibility of an attack. So once you have, in theory,
more than 50% of the network power, more than 50% of the nodes under your control, you can actually mint blocks that are not legitimate anymore, because we can just overrule everyone else and make new blocks up. What you can't do is change the past, because to recalculate all the hashes of the previous blocks that are all within the new blocks, as I said, that is just, I mean, you might go one block back or two blocks back, but I mean, like three or four blocks back, the computation that is necessary to do that is bigger than what is available on Earth. So I can't change the past, but I can still try to change the present and make up transactions that didn't actually take place. And that happened to smaller blockchains. For a big blockchain like the big Ethereum network or the big Bitcoin network with thousands of miners, and that is just not feasible. It's just too expensive to do that. I mean, I guess even state size actors like a big country like the US or China would find that difficult to do. It's not impossible. It's just very expensive. And it happened to smaller chains, like, for example, Ethereum Classics, like 2 years ago, when the network was taken over by miners of the longer Ethereum chain. But still, the coin survived. It didn't break its neck. And that is kind of reassuring for the technology. So what we have looked at in this video is the consensus mechanism of proof of work. There is a second consensus mechanism that's called proof of stake. It is, in the idea, much, much simpler. However, in execution, much more difficult. So to describe what is proof of stake is, instead of risking that my work was done in vain, because I lose everything that I put into mining the block, I have to put money on the table. You think maybe of a poker game or so. I mean, to stay in the game, you have to up the ante. You have to put money on the table to stay in the game. And that is the idea of stake. People, the miners, put money into the, I mean, they transfer their coins into a escrow. And if someone finds out that the block that they mine is fraudulent, they lose all the money. And the blocks are assigned randomly to miners, so I can never know if I get the next block. So that's the first way of securing it. So I have to wait until I randomly get to mine a block, and then I check all the transactions and say, well, this block is okay, everyone else please approve. And if someone finds out that the block is not okay, I lose all the money that I had to put in, and that is a lot of money. I think the amount for the test chain that Ethereum 2 now uses is like 30 Ether. That is, I think, currently something like $60,000. So that's painful if I lose that. And the probability to get a block assigned for mining to me is proportional to the money that I put on the table. But it's not just straight linear proportional. So if I double the money, I don't double the probability of mining the block. So I can never dominate the system by just buying my way in. I can, however, make it more likely that I can mine the blocks. And by that, I mean, I over proportionally increase the risk. If I put more money in, it is even less likely that I would defraud the system. And still, I mean, if I would want to defraud the system, I would have to kind of wait until I randomly get the block assigned, and then I have immediately to act and do my my fraudulent transactions, and then send it out, and then wait and hope that not immediately someone finds the mistake, so that I can actually cash out my money. That is very unlikely. So this is why proof of stake networks, and there are several, work. And the great advantage of proof of stake is that they are not as energy demanding as the proof of work. I mean, as I mentioned, the proof of work basically requires electricity. It is a proof that I actually spent the money on energy.
And this is the criticism towards Bitcoin and Ethereum these days, is that they use this huge amount of energy that is used to mine the blocks. And if you look into that in detail, I mean, where are the blocks mined? Is in places where energy is highly subsidized, like in China, for example, where coal is still highly subsidized. So it is in cooperation with energy providers that have excess energy. For example, I know of a company in Germany who sells mining equipment to windcraft wind power energy companies. So the wind turbines, I mean, many times of the day stay idle because there is just too much wind and not at any every time they the people actually use the energy, and you have to get rid of the excess energy. And so the energy company actually pay people to consume this energy by mining Bitcoin. But it is true that a lot of carbon dioxide is emitted through the proof of work. So it is very desirable to move to another consensus algorithm like proof of stake instead. The problem with the proof of stake algorithm is it is not so straightforward to prove it mathematically. So it is harder to build trust. And so the hope is that Ethereum will change in 2021. And we shall see the second largest blockchain network to be finally getting rid of this huge waste of energy. There is a third, not pure play, so to say, way of using the blockchain. So if you know everyone in the system, so for example, think of organizations that want to work together, they don't actually need any kind of these proofs. They just need a proof of authority, like a cryptographic key that identifies that someone is actually correctly in charge. And then they do the same as in the proof of stake network, randomly assign the control, the validation of the blocks, and everyone else then checks if the validation was right. And if someone defrauds you, they get kicked out of the consortium. This is a blockchain approach that is used in closed systems. It's called proof of authority. Well, I mentioned Ethereum, and we will look a bit further into Ethereum. So Ethereum is a network that was started about 5 years after Bitcoin, by people who were dissatisfied with the limitations of Bitcoin. So Bitcoin is just money. I mean, that is a pure play money system. But people thought, well, actually, we can do much better. We can do a lot of more things by opening up the smart contract language, not just to handle these very simple conditions, but to be kind of a full-scale computer and have certified computation. And by that, as I shall introduce in the next video, be able to create new chains out of Ethereum that run token systems, like, for example, non-fungible tokens, the NFTs that have become so famous in the digital art world. Well, this video, we introduced the consensus mechanism that resolves the problem of keeping a distributed network consistent, available, without sacrificing that it is free of hierarchy. So this consensus mechanism that was first used is the proof of work algorithm that is based on Hashcash. Of course, there is a criticism to that, that is the energy consumption. So we saw also that there is alternatives proposed like proof of stake. In the next video, we will look a bit further into Ethereum, the smart contracts, and into applications.